Hello, audience. Hello, Rush fans. This is Professor Timothy Melbinger, Penn State University, United States of America. And today I'm going to be discussing The Spirit of Radio by Canadian rock band Rush. I'm going to skip the prolonged intro I usually do about what I'm trying to do here because there's so much going on in the song. But let me just boil it down to this. I'm going to talk about more than just the lyrics, although the lyrics are important. It's the notes, the rhythms, the melodies, the harmonies, the entire musical setting, the form, the meaning of the song here that we're going to get to, and it's not going to be brief. But if you know anything at all about this song, you know that that's what's going on. That's the right way to approach it. There's so much here. I'm going to have to skip over just to hit some of the big items that I already asked for forgiveness for from the rock and roll gods. Okay, so Spirit of Radio, 1980, January 1980, from the album Permanent Waves, a year before the height of their popularity, which comes with moving pictures in 81. But this song in particular goes a long way to setting that up, to gaining them a new audience, for they had written even longer songs before this, with all kinds of prog rock techniques, but they really boiled it down here and got to something that was radio friendly, which still has more details than I can possibly get to today. Okay, so it's recorded in a place called Le Studio in Morin Heights, Quebec, Canada, but mixed in London. The producer was longtime Rush producer Terry Brown. And our three musicians here are bass player, keyboardist, singer Geddy Lee, not his real name, guitarist Alex Lifeson, not his real name, but percussionist drummer Neil Peart, yes, that was his real name. And Peart writes the lyrics as well, which are virtuosic in many ways. So, specifically, in this song, Lee is playing synthesizer, in which he plays an organ sound at one point, a string sound in another place. He's stepping on something called the torus pedals, playing sort of a synthesized string sound at another point. He's playing piano briefly at one point. He's playing bass guitar the entire time, just about, and then singing in his tenor voice. So Alex Lifeson is playing two guitars most of the time, and it makes it difficult to tease out what the individual parts are, that's for sure. But they are both electric guitars, of course. Well, he would go on to play many other guitars on other Rush albums and things that were not even guitars, like balalaika. But in this case, yeah, six string standard tuning electric guitar. And then in addition to Peart's massive drum set, he will add two things for this song, which we don't typically hear in hard rock music, and that would be glockenspiel, sometimes called orchestral bells. It's tiny little metal sh or keyboard shaped metallic instrument, plays very high notes. In addition to that, something called steel drums, which is a Caribbean sound. Okay, so this would become one of their most enduring songs for several good reasons. The musical setting, as well as the text, is a joyful tribute to the sacred time that many of us felt when we were reaching for the radio dial to hear a song, maybe any song, just try to find something we like, or maybe even a song we could just tolerate while we were doing something, right? And then we would hear those songs for the rest of our lives in some way. In many cases, hearing a song on the radio growing up would be the first time we heard a song, because they would always put the song out to the radio stations before it got to the record stores, right? This was advance promotion. So the feeling some of us have about radio, it would be difficult to describe just how positive they are. Okay, so we have a variety of accompaniments going on here. It's not just one joyous song about radio. No, there are many genres here. And that's not because there are just different sections, and yes, there are several sections. It's because they were trying to capture the joy of the radio dial, in which you turn the dial and you get different stations along the way. Okay, so because of that, I'm going to be zooming out maybe more than usual between the big picture, the overall form, and the the spectacular amount of detail here, in order to argue my point about that this is a tribute to the radio dial, the radio industry in some ways. More on that in a minute. Okay, so unlike the vast majority of pop and rock songs, we don't get to hear the title as one of the lyrics. It does not appear in the song. Okay, so what's going on there? Well, they got it as from a catchphrase from a radio station that they would use sometimes between songs, or as a little bumper and before the, or after a song would end. Imagine some, station saying KRTC in the morning, the spirit of radio. Yeah, that's what we're hearing here. It was a station. Rush fans, you can correct me if you'd like, but I believe it was a Toronto station. Okay, so the title of the song functions more like a book title. Okay, it really is about what it feels like to enjoy radio, and it's about the all the lyrics in general. Okay, so when you spin the dial, you don't know what you'd get. You'd have many chance choices, and that's how the song works. We have several varieties of music. We have 50s rock. We have progressive 70s music, the thing they were doing mostly before this. We have even a little punk rock. We have a little cheery pop rock. We have Simon and Garfunkel, or at least a quote from the famous Sound of Silence. We have reggae, okay? And more than that, we get commercials. We get larger than life radio personalities. I'll explain that toward the end of the discussion. Okay, so that's not actually something for everyone, but it's enough to convey the postmodern time when, for the first time in history, we can reach out and control what we listen to with a dial. I'm not saying the 70s were the first time in history we could do this. I mean, just, in the 20th century, when radio was in our lives. Sadly, it's not really there anymore. I don't know what the new generation does these days, but we're not getting our songs on radio as much as we used to. It's still around, I know. Okay, so the first thing I want to talk about is over here on my left. It's a chart of the overall form, and I've color-coded it. Every time you see green, it's what I call the chorus accompaniment. So that is the first music we hear. It's solo guitar. We don't know what it means, so most people just think of it as the introduction, but we will find out after about a minute in the song that it is the accompaniment, or at least the guitar accompaniment for the chorus. So I'm going to describe it as both the first section in the introduction, but also chorus accompaniment. Okay, it's called the radio waves riff. More on that in a minute. But the key is E mixolydian. More on that in a minute. We will hear 4/4 only at the very beginning. There are some meter changes and something I call a rhythmic unison. Again, I'll discuss all of this when we get to it. Every time you see this purple, it's called interlude A. And if you look on the page here, it's there briefly for only about 17 seconds before it goes away. And we don't get interlude A again until the 3.5 minute mark. The 4 minute mark, roughly, and then the last, several times in the last minute. So it disappears. It's a very famous part. It sounds like this. No. There it is. Okay, but so this is in 4/4 and also has a rhythmic unison transition before it moves on to the next part. So that's introduction part two, but it will never have words over it. It is only an interlude, something I'm calling interlude A, because, yeah, there's two interludes. Okay, introduction part three is the verse accompaniment. So this is the music We will hear as soon as, when Lee first starts singing. So we first hear it as instrumental. It's something like this. Something like that. Of course, it's guitars and not piano. And I don't have the guitar plugged in today. Maybe next time. Okay, so that goes on. There's a verse and chorus alternation that we might expect from any pop song, right? So there's the core of the song here, my red and green chorus and verse alternation. Okay, then things start to get strange or a lot of fun, depending how you look at it. Okay, after the second chorus, instead of going back to the verse accompaniment, we get interlude B. Here is music completely new, in the key of E Mixolydian again, and with meter changes such that there are two sections of 29 measures each going on here. Okay, more on the math when we get there. Okay, you'll see it makes more sense how we get to 29. Okay, also rhythmic unison as a transition to the next music after that. Okay, chorus accompaniment returns, which we haven't heard for a while, haven't we? Well, it's been something like that, and then it doesn't last very long. 7 seconds before we get the scale riff comes back. Okay, that doesn't last very long before we have the surprise of a reggae station. That's right, Rush, Canadian rock band writing, Caribbean-influenced music, and it doesn't last very long. And you'll see when I get there, it's not quite authentic, but there are a lot of things about it that make it sound, radically different for this point of the song. Okay, that disappears. We have an interruption of interlude A again, and then we get a second statement of the bridge, the Caribbean interlude, the reggae bridge. Okay, interlude A returns. It cuts that off again, and we get vocal echoes of the bridge as we move through that. Finally, guitar solo. We might have expected it earlier, but comes along for about, I don't know, 20 seconds. And then we're back to interlude A, but now with piano. So finally, just this, and we get. You know it. Okay, finally, the chorus accompaniment returns with a little ending. I'm going to call a cadence, and that's it at over 5 minutes later. Okay, I'm going to look at these things in turn now and try to keep positioning you where we are in the song with some of these details. But the first music we hear, solo guitar. It's what I'm calling the interlude A, but it might as well be called the radio waves lick. For why is he playing this? Well, hey, let's listen to it. First, solo guitar. And then, okay, Lee and Peart join with rhythmic interjections, widely varied, and there's some torus pedals in there as well. And synthesizer. It's more like a symphony at the beginning, where we hear this idea, and there's sort of a majestic entrance of the rest of the band with. Okay, let's look at that radio waves lick. Okay, it's not the same. It's charging 16th notes mostly. That doesn't even happen the whole time. But then we get four versions of it in our 4/4 measures. So each quarter note version is different. Here's A, or I'll call it the model. Here's B. Here's C. And here's D. Okay, so it's almost all 16th notes, except for triplet 16th notes, which means nothing more than he squeezes three into the time of two. So where we heard by the end becomes. There it is. Okay, so it buzzes along like something we have to imagine Something that doesn't really have sound. When you look at a radio tower, here's an example of a radio tower that seems to be, bigger than the continent of Europe for some reason. But it's sending out its radio waves. The radio waves we are strong and powerful. They've got to be strong and powerful if they're going to reach it to your little radio in your silly car, in your little town, right? Okay, so why am I saying that? Well, look, later, when we get words to this, we're going to find out about invisible airways crackle with life, bright antennae. So it's this thing, it's the radio antennae sending and receiving, right? It's not just sending, it's communication around the world, okay? Powerful throat grabbing, okay? To have a song start with blistering 16ths like this and then had to have the band jump in with such, symphonic music. I find I am interested immediately and they never let it go. Or at least they changed, we don't hear just that lick in the song, but I mean the interest grabbed from measure one. They hold on to it for the whole song. Okay, so what happens when the rest of the band comes in? Okay, so here's when we hear two guitars. There's Lifeson is playing the part I just mentioned, and then we hear he's also playing an overdriven electro distorted guitar playing here. Lee on bass is all the way down here, but he's also playing torus pedals that just articulate hold this higher sound. And Peart on drums plays just his drum cymbals and bass drum until he starts moving in unpredictable ways with the bass player. Here we go. They join in. Okay, that was just like measure three. There's a new section. Okay, so there's a lot to look at right there, I know. And again, if I'm getting something wrong in the notation here, that would be normal. It's hard to notate this music and in fact, this section in particular, very strange. It's almost like there are two tempos going on at one point. But okay, so we have music in 4-4 with these interjections and okay, a measure of 5-4 in there. Okay, what's going on? Well, Lifeson's still playing the four measures he has kept playing before and adds another first beat. Okay, the drums and bass sort of find some agreement here, ba da ba 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 dum, and then a second part of that first introduction idea starts up as before, sort of moves on as before with the, and then erupts into this very rhythmically strange idea, ba da 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 da. Here, okay, what am I talking about? All right, triplet sixteenths, da 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 da. Well, we've heard that before. That was the measure or beat four of measure one of the guitar part. Here, see, here's Lifeson doing it. Here's Lee and Peart doing it on the snare drum. Okay, so da 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 da. There it is, and then da 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 is something that lasts longer than a beat. That grouping, three sixteenths, three triplet sixteenths plus three regular sixteenths equals five regular sixteenths altogether when you only get four in one beat. So the beat unit for our rhythm section only here is 1.25 quarter notes. Okay, in the meantime, Lifeson is buzzing along in the pattern he has set up. Okay, they come together, the rhythmic unison does that twice. And then something that lasts one half of a beat with four 16th notes and one eighth note. And then the guitar joins our bass and drums for another rhythmic unison. in which the music is actually suddenly faster. Okay, now it's hard to tell what's going on because our sense of symmetry has been thrown off not only by the 5/4 measure we heard, but the new rhythmic music that lasts longer than a beat. Okay, it's okay not to know what's going on when you hear this. Or should I say, it puts you in the boat of nearly every other listener in the world wondering, hey, is this, where are we going here? Ready? Until that. And the next section. Okay, so what is that? Why would they do that? Okay? No, we should rule out incompetence. They knew exactly what they were doing. This is the first spin of the radio dial. Whatever that first song was. Right? Whatever that first song was, we've tired of it. We've had enough. And you spin the radio dial, and if you know what that sounds like, you get snippets of other stations as you move left or right on the dial, and you're trying to find that one station you like. You know it's about somewhere over here, and you get a lot of almost static, but more like snippets along the way. Okay, so our listener, we're the listeners, but we eventually land with the band on what I'm calling introduction part two, interlude. A, it will eventually be known as, and the scale riff. Okay, so E, F sharp, G natural, G sharp, A, B, C natural, C sharp, E, back to E. Yeah, there it is. Okay, it's repetitive. It climbs up a scale with a couple chromatic notes along the way that shouldn't be there in E major, but there they are. And it sounds a little like some of the guitar riffs we hear in early 50s music. Okay, with the distorted guitar, I know that's not the first thing that jumps out at you, but much later, 4 minutes later in the song, check out how Lee will add a 50s piano riff on top of this and it becomes a little more clear. Okay, things to notice about this when we hear it, because it's coming up several more times later, is look, first of all, the first time we hear it, Peart is not yet on board. When the guitars land on this low E, he plays the crash cymbal. But then the guitars move in rhythmic unison, okay, and his drum part yet has not coalesced into a beat. We hear some floor toms, another crash cymbal, nothing on the downbeat in two measures in a row, and then finally, a snare drum fill, and he ends up joining the rest of the band. But even when he does, the band comes in on something between the last quarter note of the last measure and the second quarter note of the next measure. They don't articulate the downbeats. Okay? This E here and this A here, okay? They're a little longer than than quarter notes. It's a quarter note tied to an eighth note, but that eighth note began a half a beat earlier, okay? So this is known as syncopation, and it's just a fancy term for emphasizing things between the beat. But in this case, it's not just emphasizing things between the beat, it's at the expense of the downbeat. Okay, when that happens, the music leans forward a little bit. So I'm going to count along here, trying not to ruin the song for you, so you hear what's going on. When I say one, you won't hear anything. Oh, you'll hear music that started just before I say one and just after I say one, straddling the downbeat, okay? Here we go. Transition. Three, four, one, two, three, four, and one, and two, and three, and 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 four, and one. By the end. Okay, I know that was silly. Try not to think about me doing that when you listen to the song next. But if you could hear anything above my shouting, things kept happening on and. And one and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and one, okay? And in place of one. This type of syncopation keeps the music leaning forward. It doesn't want to settle. And that's good. We want that, okay? The music is exciting in a way that I bet you haven't noticed before until I pointed this out. Okay, so where have we ended? Well, about enough of that. We get five times actually. The first riff, and then, well, okay, four times. They repeat some of this music, and then we get a transition to our next theme. Okay, so they sort of Strip things down to the bare bones. We have just this E major chord. And Peart fills that in with 16th notes on what's called the hi-hat symbol. Hi-hat symbol, two symbols inverted on each other like this that you can either play with drumsticks or trigger with your foot to make it actually, the two symbols hit each other like that. So he's actually playing it with sticks here. And the symbol is closed until the very end. See this little zero or O for open? That means with his foot, he has engaged his symbols to not touch each other anymore and they ring out. Great. And then he plays the same hi-hat with triplet eighth notes. So, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da becomes da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Okay. It's tough to tell what's going on here. Are they changing speeds? Right, we're hearing chords. And then, well, okay. As they've done a couple of times already, a rhythmic unison, when the band comes together to play the same thing, usually not chords either, usually just single notes and rhythms, we hear another new thing. Called another rhythmic unison transition into the next idea after that. Okay, so we have a formal technique here. The rhythmic unison both sets or both brings the music together, but not in a way that sounds like an ending, in a way that sounds like something that's propelling the music forward. Okay, and it's in upbeat of what's about to come. And as you guessed, it's not the last time they're going to do that. Okay, the verse accompaniment. Okay, this is the first time we hear the music that will accompany Lee's voice in a moment. We hear a cheery E major. Okay, up until this point, we've heard music in, a combination of E mixolydian, more on that later. It's E, here, I'll tell you now, it's E major with a D. Not D sharp, but regular D. So here's your scale. That's mixolydian. And then the second section is more chromatic, I mentioned, with notes that come from outside of the scale. And now we're into unambiguous, sunny E major. Okay. I can't think of another Rush song where there's this much unsullied major in a row. We have, 28 measures of E major before it slips back into mixolydian, which is slightly darker, I suppose. It happens sometimes in rock music, sure, that you get you get this much major, but they've selected, I think, selected the major in order to sound cheery. Now, there's nothing cheery about music that's just in major, okay? It's just sounds, right? But when it is juxtaposed, when it is contrasted with music in minor and music in Dorian or Lydian or this thing I was telling you about called Mixolydian, then the major sounds like it's more uplifting, and that's what's going on here. Okay, we're going to hear Lee sing positive statements about radio's positive side. Begin the day with a friendly voice. Whether that voice is a singer you like or your favorite DJ. I think many of us older people know about DJs. Some were horrible, some were very good. Okay, and the magic music makes your morning mood. Right, so whatever the song is here, immediately you found a song you like and it's made your mood. Maybe you're driving to work. Maybe you're just getting out of bed. Maybe it's waking you up. I don't know. However, let me give a shout out to Peart's lyrics right here because they don't get the attention they deserve. The line I just said, the magic music makes your morning mood. Okay, five words begin with M. Okay, that's called alliteration. Remember poetry? If you took a class in poetry in high school or college, five, magic music makes your morning mood, okay? It produces another rhythm, the rhythm of M sounds, and it's gone. He goes on to other things after that, and we'll hear more alliteration later in the song. But, it's clever, but it sounds great, okay? That many words beginning with M. Okay, so Lyson is playing two guitars here. Let's look at what this looks like, because it's very complicated. Ready? There you go. Electric guitar one, mostly open strings or in some finger notes. And there are variations on that. And the second guitar is a little further, a little fuller, with bigger chords, and then things that anticipate downbeats, fuller chords. That the bass guitar much lower. On like that, and the drum part. Oh my. Okay, so mostly the bass and snare articulating what we call the backbeat, with the bass on the first beat, the snare on the second beat, and then the same thing for beats 3 and 4. But the music he's adding here, 16th notes. Not entirely 16th notes, but a tricky pattern on what's called the ride cymbal. Okay, so one doesn't ride it anywhere, but he's playing what's called the bell of the cymbal. So the cymbal is, you know, a cymbal shape. It's sort of like that. The very top, in fact, where it sort of bubbles out a little. Some people call it the nipple, but that's where the drum stand goes through and then screws onto the top. It bubbles out a little bit at the top, and if you play right on there, it's a little more of an aggressive, a biting sound. Okay, so try to keep track of four parts in there before Lee even says anything. There's a transition to it. There's Lee's voice riding higher than any of that. Okay, so of all the things you just heard in the accompaniment, maybe, perhaps, you hear the low part prominently, I do, and then this high part that keeps coming out. Okay, so the first three times we hear that, three measures in a row, those are the two open strings in his guitar, played in both guitars, by the way. Okay, so the open strings resonate a little differently than notes you stop with your fingers. Not that much differently, but they're a little more resonant, a little more brilliant sounding. And I think he wanted that here. Okay, because it sticks out in addition to, you know, the rest of the stuff that's in the middle of the chord. Okay, that stuff. And then, well, it's something he would do in many songs. It's where he got a lot of his harmonies. Using unexpected open strings. Okay, so let's hear the beginning of Lee's singing, as in begin the day with a friendly voice, a companion unobtrusive. Note when I play this syncopation again. Recall, that is, in this case at least, there's different kinds of syncopation, but in this song we hear between the beat syncopation. Emphasis between the beat at the expense of the beat. Okay, so I've put little arrows above Lee's lyrics here. Begin the day with a friendly voice, a companion unobtrusive. So it begins on the beat, but quickly moves off of it. Okay, so note how much of it, is between the beat. Begin the day with a friend. Begin the day with a friendly voice, a companion unobtrusive. Did you hear the last four? Okay, pan and yun of companion are going to be with my claps, but then unobtrusive will be between. Pan yun unobtrusive. Okay, it matters. The music is leaning forward. If he were singing on the beat, this would not have been as big of a hit. Let me ruin it. Begin the day with a friendly voice, a companion unobtrusive. Boring. Yeah, he's shrieking in a pretty high voice, I know, and singing about friendly things, and the music below is interesting, but the music would have sat down at that point and said, ugh, I'm tired of this song, vocally tired of this song. We don't need the beat anymore. We know what's going on here. It's 4-4 time. Things that come just before the beat and last through the beat, at the expense of something new happening on the beat throughout the song. Okay, continues, plays that song that's so elusive, and the magic music makes your morning mood. Again, many things happen between the beat here. It starts on the beat, though, again. Plays that song that's so elusive. Only Lou and Siv of Elusive were between the beat. But it's so much better than plays that song that's so elusive. Agreed? Good. I won't do it for every one of them, I promise, coming up. But when you can listen to a song the wrong way, how they didn't do it, how they could have done it in a more simple way, then you can appreciate how the actual version, the one we have that got recorded, the one we've come to know and love, is far superior than some kind of skeleton or background, well, original starting point, perhaps. Okay, so back to our song. Here we go. Okay, so we hear seven times this pattern, this four measure pattern that we've heard already. The first time is the instrumental. The next two times through is, I'm calling verse one and verse two. We hear another instrumental version, and then we hear verse three and verse four, and then we hear another instrumental version. So that's seven altogether, except the seventh time they know where it's going to go if they don't change it. So that's exactly what they do. They change the last two measures, another rhythmic unison where everyone comes together in anticipation of a new section. We don't know what the new section is going to be yet, but we feel that, wait, they've come together and accelerated together. Something must be coming here. So let's listen to how that happens. Okay, the whole of verse, the verse one cycle. Here's verse one. Verse two. Accompaniment again. This is the fourth time. Five. Verse three. Verse four, sixth time. Seventh time, instrumental again. And they change it up. Section. Okay, so along the way, there's so much detail going on there, and even more than I've indicated, because I didn't even bother to notate verses three and four here in the interest of time and sanity. But let me play it one more time. Can you notice that when we first hear Peart playing along here, we get the ride that the bell symbol, the ride symbol I was telling you about. And that sort of more biting sound. But listen to what happens as soon as Lee begins to sing. Peart plays the same rhythms, but over on the hi-hat cymbal. Okay, this is a less aggressive sound because he's trying to stay out of the way of the voice part. He's not primary. The music isn't primary. The voice is primary. So he cuts back a little bit onto a different instrument, but eight measures later, when they do an instrumental version again, he goes back to the ride cymbal, which is much more aggressive. So, again, one more time through, listening to that. Ride cymbal. Oh, wait, that was the seventh time through. Let's go back a little bit more. Ride cymbal. Hard to tell it's there, but it is. The hi-hat is accompanying there. It's just less in your face than ride cymbal would be. This is what a sensitive drummer does, and this was, hey, I'll say it, the world's best drummer. There. I know we're all supposed to say it was John Bonham, but for Neil Peart to do this for 40 years? This was the best drummer in the world. Okay, the chorus. Here we go. I just played through that transition. Here we go. Okay, it begins ambiguously. First of all, we get a change of tempo. It's a little slower. We have been running along at a beat of 180 beats per minute. That's very fast. That's 3 per second, isn't it? Okay, but we slide back down to our original tempo here, 135 beats per minute, and it was what we heard. It's not new. It's what we heard with Lifeson's original lick. Okay, so what's the relationship between these tempi, by the way, the plural of tempo? Would you believe if you took the first 75% of a quarter note in quarter equals 135 and made that your new beat, okay? So 75% of beat of tempo one becomes tempo two. Yeah, there's actually a mathematical relationship between their beats here. It's not explicit on the surface of the music, but once you listen to the numbers, if you care to take a metronome to it, you say, wait a second, those numbers are related, and they are. Okay, so Peart shockingly just goes to playing bass drum. It's called four on the floor when you just play the bass drum with your foot right here, as if he, well, forgot how to drum. But we need a contrast here, all right? So the music has been charging along for over a minute, and we just flatten out on an E major harmony, and then Lifeson, no, Lee goes to playing keyboards, a low note, and okay, it sounds better than that. It's some kind of effect laden and percussive organ sound with more of a click as well as pitch. Okay, it doesn't do much. It just runs in place. And then speaking of what running in place, twice as fast come the 16th notes we know from measure one, that. Okay, so is that the last layer we get? No way. We hear the reason for the Peart's change of drumming from everything like an octopus at one time to just quarter notes on the bass drum. It's because he's grabbing a new implement. It's called a beater for the glockenspiel, and he plays notes that are way up here. Okay, our new high notes, the highest notes in the song, actually. Here, and it is a texture like none other in any Rush song or any rock song. Look, glockenspiel is an instrument we hear in marching band because it's very, very high pitch, cuts through, and you can play the melody and hear it even in the stands when you're listening to a high school band or whomever play at halftime, right? Well, at this point, what is it really? Well, accompanying Lifeson's fast guitar part. It sounds like the overtones, the very, very high pitches that shine above someone's other music. Way up there. Okay, overall, they're trying to make this sound like magical time. Okay, why? Well, because he's going to keep speaking of more positive elements about radio. In fact, the thing I mentioned earlier, in which the radio tower is bristling with energy. Bright antennae crackle with life. Okay, this is the bristling. This is the crackling with life. Here we go. No, that's the verse. Let me go ahead a little bit. A little further. Here we go. Well, at least transition to the chorus. Okay, then Lee joins them with a new line up on G sharp again. That was one of the most important notes in the verse. This is when Geddy Lee still had powerful high notes. Not long after this, in fact, later on this record, and then again, a moving pictures, and then the entire rest of the 80s and 90s. And the 21st century, he's singing in a lower voice. He needed to make his voice last. Obviously, this was going to last. Their band was going to last. Their touring was going to be grueling. He couldn't sing up as high as he was once before, but at least he's still fairly high up there on G sharp, at least a lot higher than I can sing. I won't even try. Okay, so there we go. Invisible airways crackle with life. Bright antennae bristle with the energy. Once again, syncopation. Between my claps, bright antennae bristle with the energy. Right? Great stuff. I won't ruin that one with how it could have been if everything stayed on the beat. Okay, a second time through that pattern sees Peart switch back to hi-hat work and away from the glockenspiel. So you don't really miss it. It was there. We've probably heard enough of glockenspiel, honestly. It's very high. We got the point. His part did not change much, but he goes back to 16th note drumming on, well, playing of the hi-hat. I should say this is at a time when Neil Peart is influenced by, what's his name? The drummer for The Police. Not Summers, that was guitar player. Not Sting, that was the bass player, but, Stuart Copeland. And Copeland's hi-hat work on the Police albums at this time are, you wouldn't think two cymbals inverted on each other like that could play virtuosically. Well, think again when Copeland and then Peart took over. Okay, so note the slight change just about when we've had enough of the glockenspiel and to hi-hat. Transition back to the verse structure. Let me point out one last thing there, and that would be he starts talking about a negative element about the radio industry. He says, bearing the gifts beyond price, almost free. Why didn't he say free? Isn't radio free? No, radio's not free. You all know the reason you spin the dial is to get away from horrible commercials, okay? And commercialism, right? These commercials are not pleasant sometimes. They're pretty horrible interjections into your, morning mood. All right, so more on that when he gets more explicit. Okay, we hear verse 2. In fact, let me jump back to tell you where we are in the overall big picture. We hear verse 2 and then a repeat of chorus 2. So far, so good. Introduction and chorus, verse, chorus, verse, chorus. Right? This is like 90-whatever percent of songs that are out there. Here we are with the red, green, and red, green in my chart for verse, chorus, verse, chorus. The second verse begins with no introduction, no accompaniment version first. Lee just starts charging right ahead with all this machinery making modern music. Here's where he distorts his voice a little bit. Here's where Lifeson starts playing a little more gritty and with ostentatious, yes, slides between his guitar chords. It's a little more, but not exactly, like punk, which was more popular in the late 70s and the very beginning of the 80s, until it, sort of flamed out, if it ever flamed out. Okay, so the chorus returns and is much like what we heard before, again, with no accompaniment first. They jump right into Invisible Airways. Okay, at the end of chorus 2, what would you expect happens next? Well, you would expect us to get back to verse accompaniment. Most songs do that, right? Well, instead of that, there is an overlap. The last note he sings for the chorus becomes the first beat of a new section coming forward. This is what I call interlude B. Interlude B, well, in which they discover that, wait a minute, they are a progressive rock band and they haven't done anything in 7 yet. Lots of music in 4, A little strangeness, one measure of five, right? Oscillation between triplets and other things, right? And we've had two tempo changes, that's good. But what we hear in this section, let me get to it here, is changing meters. What I mean in particular are a measure of four followed by a measure of three. Where are you? Interlude B. There you are. A measure of four followed by a measure of three. That's a grouping of seven. Okay, look, once a song begins in 4-4, you have every right to believe it's going to keep moving in 4-4 because 99% of songs do just that, and you stop worrying about it after a while. But when you hear a measure of 3 suddenly give way then to another measure of 4, and you hear another pattern of 7, that's going to grab your attention, catch you off guard, whatever metaphor you want to use here. Okay, so we hear a new chord progression, moving up from E to F sharp to G sharp, back from F and back to E. And, well, that's not entirely new. Now, these are the bass notes that Lee was playing just on the Taurus pedals in the chorus the first time and the second, and just climbed up and down there. But now they're much more active and in this new pattern. Okay, 7 plus 7 plus 7 plus 8, that's 29. And then they do it again for another group of 29. So just when, if you were starting to get the idea, I get it, there we have groupings of 7 here, they throw in a grouping of 8. Okay, not allowing you to get fully comfortable. This whole section not only has the prime number of 7 in it, but the prime number of 29 by the end it is not stable. Okay, they want the music to be leaning forward, to gather energy again, and probably in order to make the next section that is more stable, more memorable. And that's exactly what will happen. We don't know what's coming next, but we know this section is a little strange. Okay, so our harmony again, our scale is Mixolydian. It's like E major with a D in it, okay? And we actually get D major harmonies here in addition to E major and A major. Okay, so let's listen to that, and I'll count along, hopefully not too outrageously. Here we go. Okay, so here's chorus two. I think, yeah. Same as chorus one. We'll skip ahead a little bit. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, one. And then we're back to the verse accompaniment. Okay, now there is so much going on in the drums and bass part there that I've only notated the first half of it, the first 29. No two measures are equal. I shouldn't say that. That's not true. There's a little bit of, measure one is the same as measure three, but after that, all bets are off. So even when it would have been the easier thing to lock into a groove of seven to make sure that, hey, do you hear this? Banging out the seven, banging us over the head with it. That's it. Seven. They can't do it. They can't. We get all kinds of syncopation within the beat in our measures of seven, and then they can't even finish the deal with another group of seven. We hear eight towards the end. Okay, so what do we hear? Our stable verse accompaniment. It was a clear 4-4 when we heard it before and when Lee started singing before. So that was my point, and why I think they wrote that interlude in such a strange metric structure in order to get back to something we know and love, 4-4, something stable. Okay, here we go. Here it is, verse accompaniment again. What's different? Well, we have a higher melody. Well, here, up here, and G sharp, and A, B, and E. It's a synthesizer melody. It's the same as the bass line, just in whole notes. Okay, that's it's promoting Lee's bass part to be the lowest thing and now the highest thing in the texture. You know, not I'm not going to call it a synthesizer solo. It's mostly just whole notes, but so yes, it's something we've heard before, but a new variation of it. Okay, what's going to happen next? I don't know. Guitar solo, maybe the song ends, maybe another chorus. Here we go. Ah, measure one. We haven't heard you in quite a while since, well, the first 30 seconds of the song. Finally, that's come back. Okay. With its different tempo, I might point out. We were flying by in quarter equals 180 for a while, and now it's back to 135. But I know it sounds faster than that because of the blistering 16th notes. Great. Our initial accompaniment, initial lick is back in the guitar. Nope, gone. That's the same rhythmic unison we heard in the first 30 seconds of the song. And where did that take us before? Do you remember? It was what I'm calling interlude A, the scale riff. Yes? Let's see if it does it again. Yes, it does. Okay, great. Been quite a while since we've heard this, right? Good for them. But then it peters out. It sounds like we almost have a new singer. Lee is singing down here. For the words of the prophets were written on the studio walls. An octave lower than he's been singing most of the song. More than that, we have two clean guitars playing a new rhythm. We have Peart playing. Playing drums in, well, here, let me show you some of this stuff. There we go. There's my notation of the first measure and the second, with some dry hi-hat work, some snare drum work, but it's the snare drum where he lays a stick over the top of the drum head and plays with the stick with the other stick. It's more of a click than a snare drum sound. And then we even have some of the steel drums in here. Okay, listening again. What's going on? Well, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. Then we have something else. Okay, halftime, as in not between a sporting match, but I mean they have cut the tempo to the half of the speed it was. You can hear the old one, two, three, four, if you like, but the way the drumming works, we hear an expanded beat, and it's actually twice as long. So that our new beat is, well, 77.5. That's half of 135. Again. And then back to the scale riff. What is going on? This late in a song, we shouldn't be hearing new music. There it is. It's almost like a novel when we have a new character come in late in the game, and that's an important character, not just someone walking across the stage. You don't expect this. I don't expect this. I find it shocking every time I hear it. In fact, shocking that it's reggae from a band that specializes in well, something between heavy metal and progressive rock. Okay, but wait, what is he saying? Maybe that'll give us a clear. He says, "For the words of the prophets were written on the studio wall, then concert hall." Okay. Sound like something else? It is. It's Simon and Garfunkel's famous line from their 1964 hit, "The Sound of Silence," also featured in the 1960 what, seven or eight film, "The Graduate," right? He sings, "For the words of the prophets were written on the subway walls and tenement halls," right? So what is Lee doing? Well, he's alt or well, It's not Lee. It's Lee is singing it, yes, but Peart's quoting Simon or Paul Simon and saying, "For the words of the prophets." But it's not prophets, as in "I am a prophet giving you a vision of the future." No, look at what we have here. Words of the prophets, as in cold cash, as in the money you make after you've spent what you needed anyway, the extra money. Okay, you don't hear that when you first hear it because it's a homonym, right? It's a homophone, right? Where you hear, you know, like there and they and they are as there, something like that, right? Prophets and prophets sound the same, but he's talking about the downside of the music industry, the downside of the radio industry again. Okay, so it's written on the studio wall. That's not subway walls from the original Simon and Garfunkel. And then he goes back into his higher tenor voice with concert hall. Okay, it was supposed to be tenement hall, and he says concert hall. So we leave the bleak, well, in at least the sound of silence, it was the bleak sound of the city at night and tenement halls for the, well, the rock concert at night for concert hall. Okay, so at that moment, we get an interruption is the best way I can describe it, of our interlude A scale riff, you remember? That kind of thing. And we hear crowd noise. Not just crowd noise, like milling around in the subway. No, no. Crowd noise from the concert hall. Hear it? Now, let's hear the whole thing again. The steel drum part, by the way, it's subtle. It's barely there. Okay, so that's what it's like to go to a Rush concert. That kind of noise. You are in the crowd. And that's what it becomes like to go to a Rush concert for the next 34 years after this. Yeah, that's right. My entire experience with Rush concerts was after this record. And so we are meant to cheer loudly at that point. And the lighting crew takes over and they shine the light out onto you to remind you, hey, your part here. Okay, but why? Why do this? Yes, he says concert hall, I know. But what else was popular in the late 70s? Live albums, okay? What started it? Do you remember? It was Peter Frampton's Frampton Comes Alive, and it was Cheap Trick live at Budokan, wasn't it? It was, okay? Every band after this has to go out and produce a live album after this, including Rush. Rush already had a live album just already before this. The live acts at the time, the 70s bands who were touring all around the country and world, at an unhealthy pace, they will all tell you, we're gaining crowd, we're earning what their audiences through great live performance, and they wanted to prove that through live albums. So we get a taste of a live album here. We get the same music we've heard before, right? The interlude A, except now it's live. It's a different version of the same song. But then it's gone again. We're back to the reggae music. Okay, you know the Simon and Garfunkel song. You probably know it, right? Echoes with the sound of what? The sound of silence. What would be the opposite of silence? Okay, noise, right? We've heard noise already. He says the sound of salesmen. And if you know anything about listening to the radio, radio commercials are the worst. The salesmen try to squeeze in their sales pitch in 30 seconds or less. Sometimes they speak so fast, it's a virtuosic display of bullshit, but it's virtuosic just how fast they can speak. Okay, but more than that, the commercials for whatever they're selling, more than just voices, if it's some silly DJ telling you this is brought, you know, this hour is brought to you by whatever, you know, band down, whatever grocery store or that, it's loud, it's in your face, it's louder than the music sometimes. And it's still this way on TV if you listen carefully. Okay, so instead of the sound of silence, it's the sound of salesmen. And we get the return of riff A. Sorry, interlude A. Right? And Lee sings it three times of salesmen, a little higher. A salesman, a salesman. He gets to his highest note in the pitch, which is E, E above the E above middle C. Okay? So he's insistent, like salesmen. There's one. A salesman! Sorry to try to sing along there. Okay, so we get commercials. But it's not just that. It's not just a mention, a nod to the radio commercials and radio business, right? They got it. That's where it's not free. You pay dearly by having to listen to awful commercials with radio and TV, don't you? Okay, it's more than that. Lifeson's guitar solo here is supposed to be crass salesman coming in and saying things l louder than well, larger than life. That's what I'm trying to say, and a little louder than they should. Okay, to this end, he uses what we call a wah pedal, which makes the which makes guitar sound a little vocal. Okay, here's what I mean. Did you hear almost the words wah in there? Okay, it's a pedal you press while you're playing a bunch of notes, and you end up getting something that sounds like, again. Here we go. Okay, he does an outrageous wah at the end, well, near the end of the solo. I think that's about the two-thirds point. Okay, so yes, you get a guitar solo that you might not notice is any different than any other guitar solo at first, with all kinds of notes flying around from Lifeson. Great. However, upon further review, after some reflection, you realize, wait a minute, this is still radio. These are the commercials. Okay, so that peters out in favor of interlude A. Well, here's the guitar solo end. And we get by our bass player who plays keyboards as well. And that's it. That's the entire guitar solo or piano solo. He doesn't do anything to make a new melody. It's not a melody. It's percussive. It is the kind of guitar solo our early rock and roll pianists like Jerry Lee Lewis, not Jerry Lee Lewis, oh my God, is that it? What was his name? Wait, don't, Jerry Lewis, that's it. Great Balls of Fire, right? Would do. It's just very simple. It's innocent. It was late 50s, early 60s rock, where at least rock began. I mean, there was radio plenty of decades before that, but that's what they're trying to do here, give a nod to early rock and roll. And oh, and all we get rather than just that, we finally get a piano glissando at the end. Wait, right here. Okay, here we are, the end of the song. You wondered if you'd ever get there. I know, I did my best. I'm skipping so much. There's so many details. I could write a book about this song, or maybe I should. Anyway, so here's the end of the piano solo. And there, okay? And then we get a final interlude A, but only the first half of it. One might call it the head. Okay, so just the first two measure, just the first measure twice, okay? Where our drummer Peart cuts out with just per not percut well, of course he's playing percussion. I mean, just with some punctuations of the end of it, and then just when you think it was gone forever, we get one final measure of the 16th note music from measure one from Lifeson, and for the first time since measure one and two, solo right here. And then we have cadence, where not much happens there. Okay, so look, instead of as of a four beat measure just before we that happens. It comes in an eighth note early. Da 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 da. Right, right on the last eighth note of our eighth notes in 4-4, in which each quarter note divides into two, so you get eighth notes. Rather than hearing the eighth note, we hear a literal interruption of the 16th notes, so as our new downbeat. So that's a measure of 7/8. There are only 7/8 notes there. Now, again, going back to measure one, that riff is so throat grabbing that maybe you don't even notice that the first 20 or 30 times you listen to it. But if you really count the eighth notes, one is missing. And then we hear, I don't know, a big drum fill and some long notes. They throw the brakes on the music with these last few measures and, you know, having truncated versions of earlier themes right here. They're telling us, look, this is, you've heard this before, but here's a different version, a little less of it, because the units are getting smaller as we approach silence, as we approach the end, and that is it. Okay, it's a wild ride from start to finish. There's a core of a standard verse chorus in there, but lots of moving parts and lots of transitions or interruptions to where you can never quite tell what's going to happen next. And don't you want that? I mean, in a genre that is sometimes horribly predictable, almost oppressively predictable, you want to be able to have a song every once in a while that's constantly surprising you. And in this case, it's a combination of different styles along the way. They want to prove, as if they want to prove they can play in different styles of music. But I think you hear at the very least contrast, okay? And you know, contrast is not new, but for music or for rock, but the degree of contrast in this song is severe. Overall, it's joyous, though. He does say things about glittering prizes and endless compromises shatter the illusion of integrity. And if you know anything about the band Rush, if you are a Rush fan, you know that is the number one adjective to describe the band. Integrity over 40 years of music. Well, they kept their integrity, and the song remains joyful from beginning to end, okay? Because that's how they felt about radio. That's how I felt about radio growing up. It was one of my best friends. More on that some other time. Anyway, how things would change 11 years later in 1991, when a small band from Seattle would change rock music history and mock the sense of spirit, the sense of energy itself, with a new style called grunge and a song called Smells Like Teen Spirit. That songwriter would kill himself not long after that, and Rush would produce 12 more studio albums, fully embracing the fullness of life and an energy in every single one, and in every live album after that, that I am so thankful for. Thank you, Rush. Thank you, audience, for your time and attention. Check back with my channel. More songs coming up soon. Mm-hmm.